Hi everyone, welcome to this video on the atomic emission spectra experiment. Today we will build the spectroscope, an instrument used to measure wavelengths of light. We will calibrate our spectroscope and use it to measure light sources from various elemental gases. First, you will remember from our discussion in lecture that light that is emitted by elemental gases, for example hydrogen or the noble gases, is composed of individual wavelengths of light. This is referred to as a line spectrum, and it's different from a continuous spectrum, which is what you will see if the light source is sunlight, for example. The difference between the two types of spectra is illustrated in the picture below. Here in the background, in darker color, we have the continuous spectrum that we will see from, let's say, sunlight. This is what we call a rainbow. The more intense lines, however, are the actual spectrum taken when we use helium gas as the light source. In other words, if we look at helium, the helium spectrum, everything else is black except for these lines. Similarly, if you look at light sources from other elemental gases, you see line spectra as well. The difference between the different gases is where the lines are located, which corresponds to various wavelengths. Our experiment today is to look at these line spectra and determine the actual value of their wavelengths. To do so, we must build a spectroscope, an instrument that allows us to see individual waves of light. The spectroscope you will build is shown here on the left. There are several components. First, you have 2 meter sticks that have been attached together to form a letter T. In the middle of the T, you'll place a power source, which is the black box shown here, and then when you're ready, put a gas discharge tube in it. This is just a tube containing a specific elemental gas. When you turn on the power source, you will see light coming out of the tube, just like a light bulb. Near the bottom of the T, you'll place a ring stand to which you screw on a utility clamp. On the utility clamp, you'll place a diffraction grating. The way to observe the emission lines is by looking through the diffraction grating to the left or to the right of the light source. This is indicated in this diagram below. You'll see lines from various colors, which corresponds to various wavelengths. The two sides are repeats of each other, so you can choose to look at either side. An actual view is shown here, where this bright pink color corresponds to the actual light source, and then the less intense lines here are the actual wavelengths in the emission spectrum. The lines will be positioned along the meter stick, so you can measure their distance from the center of the meter stick. You can then convert these distances to actual wavelengths. To do that, you're going to need a conversion equation. This can be obtained by calibrating the spectroscope, which just means to measure the distances of the lines with known wavelengths. We will do this using a mercury gas discharge tube. Mercury has 4 lines corresponding to the 4 wavelengths shown here. What you will do is measure the position of each of these lines on the meter stick. Once you have all the values, you can then do a linear regression in Excel to obtain your line equation. Here's a quick example. Let's say you measure the distance of each line from the center of the meter stick and get these values. Plot the distance and wavelength in Excel and you get the following line with its equation. Now, you can use the equation to convert waves from any other light source. For example, in the question, it says that you use helium and you get a line at 20.89 centimeter. Plugging that into the equation gives us a wavelength of 472.4 nanometer. One light source you have to use today is hydrogen gas. As we learn in lecture, the Bohr model of the hydrogen atom can be used to calculate the wavelength of emission lines that will appear for hydrogen. As a reminder, the equation is called the Rydberg equation, and it looks like this. Delta E, which is the change in the energy of the electron due to its transition from one Bohr orbit to another, is equal to the negative of the Rydberg constant times 1 over n final squared minus 1 over n initial squared. The n value refers to the Bohr orbit values, initial and final positions of the electrons. Recall that when the electron moves from a higher Bohr orbit to a lower Bohr orbit, energy is emitted as a photon of light, and the energy of a photon of light is equal to hc over lambda. So lambda, or wavelength, can be calculated if we let the energy of light equal to the energy of the electron transition. We use an absolute value here because the wavelength is always a positive value. Here's a quick example on how to do this calculation. A student finds a wavelength of 488.2 nanometer for hydrogen. Which transition is closest to this wavelength? And what's the percent error in the accuracy? So one fact you want to remember from our discussion and lecture is that visible light wavelengths in the hydrogen atom is generated when the n final is equal to 2. So what we can do is try different values for n initial to see which one comes closest to 488.2. This turns out to be an n initial equal to 4, which gives us a wavelength of 486.1 nanometer. We can then calculate the percent accuracy by taking the difference between the two numbers and then divide it by the theoretical value, giving us 0.432%. Let's now talk about the experimental steps. You can follow the steps in the lab procedure, but keep the following in mind. Once you calibrate the spectroscope, you shouldn't move any part of it, or you'll need to recalibrate it. You can use tape to prevent the different parts from moving. When you look at the mercury lines, the blue lines will often be hard to observe, but keep in mind that it should be between the violet and the green lines. There are three light sources you're going to use today: mercury, a noble gas, and a hydrogen gas. The mercury is what you will use to calibrate. The noble gas is an example of a polyelectronic element, which is part B of your lab. And the last part is the hydrogen gas. Let's look at the noble gas more carefully. You can choose any noble gas that is available to you, and you should try to identify 4 to 5 lines from it. Make sure to pick the sharpest and brightest lines. Here, for example, the middle one is the actual light source, and then to the left and right are repeats of the same series of lines. It's probably best in this case to choose the blue, the yellow, the red, and the violet right here as the lines you can measure. You don't really want to choose the green one here because that green line is very smeared out and it's very hard to see exactly what the position of the green line is. Now, once you calculate the actual wavelength of these lines using your conversion equation, you have to find the correct wavelength value. To do this, you're going to consult a table from an organization called the NIST, which is the National Institute of Standards and Technology. The link to get to this values is provided in your lab manual. Some information about the NIST data is given here. The table you will see will look similar to the one shown here. I have cropped this table so it only shows the first two columns. The first column is wavelength in unit of angstroms, which is the letter A with a degree symbol on top of it, and that's equal to 10 to the minus 10 meter. The second column is the intensity or brightness of each of those lines. When you look at the data, make sure you scroll down to the part that says wavelength in air, not in vacuum. To compare your experimental value, choose the wavelength that is closest to your value with the highest intensity. Here's an example. Let's say you found a line with wavelength of 444.5 nanometer from your spectroscope. This means that it will be equal to 4,445 angstroms. If you look at the list, you see that the closest value is 4,437 angstroms, but that line has an intensity of 3, which is unlikely to be observable by naked eye under the condition in the lab. More likely, the line you saw was the one with wavelength 4,471 angstroms with intensity of 200. So when you're calculating a percent error, you should calculate it against this wavelength instead of the 4,437 angstrom line. For the hydrogen source, you should be able to see three lines clearly. The fourth line, which is located in the violet region near ultraviolet, will be hard to see. All the lights in the room will be turned off to help see the lines clearly, but you may still need to cover your experimental area with blankets provided by your instructor to make the area even darker. As far as safety is concerned, you'll need to put on your standard PPE. A reminder that the power source used in this experiment has very high voltage, so please don't touch it when it's on and plugged in. If you want to move the power source, make sure it's off and unplugged. The gas tubes would be extremely hot after they've been on for a while. So after you turn them off, don't immediately touch them or you'll burn your skin. Don't forget to return all the equipment back to the instructor after use. Okay, that ends the video description of the atomic emission lab. Thanks for watching.